I've always liked nights. In fact, I used to really look forward to them. Time to read, chat, catch up on television, and midnight snacking. Nights no longer remind me of chilling and reading. Instead, they remind me of panic, of chaos, of despair, and of death. I actually dread them now. Nights remind me of the deep-seated helplessness that came with the endless phone rings, and I don't like nights anymore. It took me a long time to talk about all that happened in those 3 months, and even longer time to process it. This is the first time that I'm here on a platform talking about my journey with COVID and all that came with it. April 2021 was probably the worst time that our generation has seen. A major second wave of COVID-19 hit India, taking the caseload to over 2.5 million. We all lost a loved one, a friend, a relative, a parent, or a neighbor. We not only saw people go through pain, but suffered it ourselves. The pandemic has led to over 220 million cases and over 4.5 million deaths till date. It has claimed the lives, hopes, jobs, and aspirations of millions of Indians, causing what will probably be one of the biggest crises that a generation ever sees. We saw how citizens, young people, everyday folks struggled to save the lives of those they loved. As the healthcare infrastructure collapsed, we saw desperation, chaos, angst, and despair. Amidst this chaos emerged acts of kindness and courage, young people who rallied to the best of their abilities. Schools, colleges, organizations, and initiatives led by students helped to pool in resources, arrange for oxygen, or find out the availability of beds. I am the co-founder of one such initiative called COVID Fighters India, which emerged as one of the largest COVID aid and verification initiatives. There was a time our phones would ring constantly, text messages, calls, notifications. This is how most of them read. Oxygen needed in Faridabad, any leads? Any beds available in Vasant Kunj? Need A+ donor in Saket? Please contribute to the fundraiser to help my mother fight COVID. SOS. Where do you start? What do you do? Whose message do you respond to first? Your mother's sister or your best friend's father? Who do you help? Who all can you really help? That's when I knew I needed to do something. It was out of desperation and angst and the constant drowning in helplessness. I couldn't do it anymore. No one around me was doing what needed to be done. I was lucky to have not lost someone close. But seeing my closest people go through loss and pain, that seemed personal. Everything I did with CFI or CFI, it became personal. But this talk is not about me. This talk is not about how we set up CFI. This talk is about the thousands of young people who selflessly came together to truly show us what can happen when we come together as one. I don't like nights anymore. We got a frantic call from Bangalore around midnight asking if we knew of any vacancies. We started calling hospitals and I remember that night very clearly because a lot of us worked on that case. We called 10, 20, 40 hospitals. 125 hospitals, one response. There is no space. Please ask them to be on the list. We didn't find a bed till 6 a.m. even going through all our resources, scavenging through our contacts, nothing. We didn't receive a starter pack on what it's like to be a COVID volunteer. We weren't taught how to build boundaries or deal with survivor's guilt. When do you stop? When do you know it's time to give up? Do you give up? We did find a bed next morning around 11 a.m. and the patient survived. But a lot of them didn't. I don't like nights anymore because not all SOS calls were helped and not all patients made it till the morning. Hospitals were full, beds were occupied, oxygen was unavailable, and all that people could do was wait. Wait for help, wait for a vacancy, wait for hope. What soon became our enemy after COVID was unverified resources, often recycled and exhausted resources. Numbers would turn out to be wrong and scams started happening. People were being cheated, people were being told off, and people were suffering. People were dying. And that's when we realized the need to pause. To pause and verify, we soon started working on verifying everything that was on the internet, Instagram stories, WhatsApp messages, forwards, everything that was circulated. But 10 people couldn't do this alone. We needed people to show up. And they did. What united us was our common sufferings and anxieties around all that we had seen. It was a common feeling of helplessness, being shut at home, just the desperation to help someone out. Our loss, personal or not, is what brought us together. The guilt of not doing enough or the need to want to do more is what brought us together. I remember getting a message. I lost my best friend due to lack of oxygen, and before he died, I promised him that I will never let anyone go through it again, that I will work to make sure that no one dies because of lack of oxygen. I want to honor that promise. Please tell me how I can help. 13,000 people, 13,000 different stories, 13,000 reasons to volunteer, but one goal, just to help. I don't like nights anymore. Some nights were harder than others. Patient 0260 looking for an oxygen bed in Delhi. We knew it was a race against time and it was a race that we were ready to run. We started dialing hospitals. Patient 0249. The patient was too critical. They had to be transferred. What if they travel and they don't get space? What if they survive the route? What if they don't? Should we look for a home ICU? Patient 0219. We needed an ICU bed. We needed a ventilator. We needed an oxygen with the ventilator. We need to reach them now. We found an ambulance. You can stop searching now. If the patient is no more, thank you for your help. Who do you blame? The people? The lack of resources? The system? Time? Yourself? Who is responsible? Are we all responsible? We didn't know what we were signing up for, or at least I didn't. None of us were frontline workers or trained to deal with loss, immense loss. Loss that might not be ours to lose. For me, what mattered most was the people we couldn't save. There were better nights when we were able to help all the SOS calls. There were bad nights and there were better nights. But tonight? Tonight is a good night because I get to share with you the story of all people who came together and built a community. A community that offered help, support, and space to grieve. I learned three things. First, people are inherently good. Everyone who worked showed us the power of selflessness. Second, kindness requires courage. It's easier to shut everything out, but it's a battle to keep going every day, to fend not just for yourself, but for everyone around you, for people you don't know, for people you may never meet. Third, communities empower you. If it wasn't for the community that volunteered, we wouldn't have been able to save so many people. If it wasn't for the community, so many of us wouldn't be here today. So this talk is about people like Pavni, Arshia and Yukti who showed up even after going through loss. This talk is about people like Manya who came up even when they had COVID themselves. This talk is about Aniket, Astha, Arushi and Isha who worked on multiple shifts every day. This talk is about Vedansh, Subhangi, Anushka and Raghav who dialed hundreds of numbers every day. This talk is about every young person like you who showed up. Because sometimes all that matters is that you show up. I want to leave you with two questions. What is the one thing that you want to change? And how will you bring people together to make that change? I didn't like nights, but maybe after today, I do.